Hello, and welcome to AK Soufflé. You'll notice that there's no silly background studio today, and for no better reason than that I couldn't find anything that was really suitable, that was appropriate for my guest, because it is the wonderful James Ledward. James, thank you for coming back once again to Soufflé.
My pleasure.
I've asked you to come in today because, as you're aware, I'm working on a big heritage project here in Brighton called Live and Let Live, which is about the city's gay culture and gay history. And as you're a big gayer and you've been out on the scene here since the 1980s?
Yeah.
The late 80s.
Yes.
Well, that's make you older than you are.
Yeah, the late 80s.
But you've been very much at the centre of Brighton's gay scene now for over 30 years. Yeah. Really, through the magazine, you must have seen everything that's happened in terms of politics, health, police, mm-hmm. and also on the social scene. That's been, you know, it's changed massively. When you first came down to Brighton, where were the bars and the clubs that you went to?
Well, I moved to Brighton in 84, 85, and the bar then was the Bulldog. Mm-hmm. And
that was back in the sticky carpet days, wasn't
that's
it?
That's right, and when it was still very small, it hadn't been
extended,
made larger.
Had it, yeah.
It was extended. And then
I mean, it's hard to believe aquarium. Anyone who goes to the Bulldog now would find it extraordinary to think that that is an extended version.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was tiny.
It was tiny, and the aquarium were the two bars over here. Mm-hmm. And over in Hove, you had the Beacon Royal.
Well, Beacon Royal was the big draw on that's Saturday right. nights, particularly. Yes. Everyone dashed to the Beacon Royal.
My memory of the Beacon Royal was on the very first time I went there. I parked my car outside and was just going into the hotel because the nightclub was below.
It was downstairs, yeah.
That's right. And as I went up the steps to the hotel, somebody was thrown out the window. And I went in, and somebody who became a very dear friend of mine, a trans woman called Bieber, had been upset by somebody and
had
ejected and turfed them out the window. And that's always my memory of arriving at the Beacon Royal.
My memory of the Beacon Royal, there's two very strong memories. I mean, we went every weekend. That's where you went. This was pre-Revenge opening.
Yeah.
But we went every weekend, Saturday nights. The gents' toilets always flooded.
Yeah.
The floor was always wet. And on Sundays, and this bar isn't there anymore, we used to go to the Oriental
yeah.
and watch drag. And then at 2 o'clock, because the licence was till two, at 2 o'clock we used to dash across the road in the back entrance to the Beacon and down the steps to watch strippers, mm-hmm. male strippers. And there was this sort of mass emigration of gay men rushing across that road, the traffic in chaos.
Yeah.
Because we would go over there because somehow they had a different licence and carried on serving beers.
Them were the days. Well, we would have had the 24-hour... customer licence, wouldn't they? You know, residence licence at the Beacon Royal.
But none of us were residents, were we?
Well, did that matter?
Well, I mean, it was interesting. I mean, that is interesting. I mean, licensing in those days was very different. I mean,
absolutely.
Lots of the bars that we went to then would close at 11. Mm. And on Sundays, they would close at 2 or yeah. 3 later on. And it was there was sort of mass emigration then to other places where you could go. Where did you used to go to?
I used to go to the Long Branch. So on a Sunday afternoon, we'd go down to the aquarium or the Bulldog for a drink. And then we'd go over to the Long Branch and you had to have a bag of chicken nuggets.
That's right. Yeah.
Because you could only buy a drink with food. And even, you know, in the early days, that was the old Revenge licence. They had to have food to serve to you.
Really?
Yeah, when you look back at the licensing laws are very odd.
I don't ever remember having food at Revenge.
No, but it was always there because it was a condition of their licence.
So they had to have the option of food. That's right. But actually, I remember at Long Branch, which had been Liam's before that,
that's
hadn't
right,
it?
Yeah.
They actually used to give you the food on that's the way right. in. Mm-hmm. And then people used to leave it on a shelf on the stairs because no one wanted to eat it, did they?
Mm.
It was terrible. They were very, very different days in terms
they
of
they were very
of,
different
of clubs.
Days, yeah.
Were you... bothered, were you there at clubs when they were raided by the police? Because in those days, the police did check more yeah. regularly than perhaps they do now.
Yes, over the years, I can remember being in the old Curtain Club when it was raided.
Now, Curtain Club was underneath the Queen's Hotel.
The Queen's Hotel, yeah. That was very early. That was when I was visiting Brighton from London regularly before I came to live here.
Yeah.
But much later, I can remember being in Wyndham's when it was raided. I'd been in many bars.
What would happen when the police raided? The
police would just come in and they would close the place down and they would take all our names and addresses.
And did they pursue you after taking your names and addresses?
I never had any problems. And so I'd over the years, two or three times, names and addresses were taken. And I can never personally remember having any problems. But I know people that did have problems. And I know details that were taken that came up in murder investigations later and stuff like that.
What were they looking for?
They would say that they were enforcing the terms of the licence. But it was a good old... it was a way... At that time, it was a way that they just... terrorised us. and, you know, the same police that would raid a bar you'd find down at Duke's Mound later on, patrolling there. So, yes.
Oh, patrolling, not cruising.
No.
Well, sure some of them did.
I'm sure some of them did.
What was your favourite place to go out to back in the 80s?
I think my favourite place was the aquarium. I used to love going there.
It was a very friendly bar, wasn't it?
It was very
friendly.
And
it was quite mixed.
Very, very small. Mm. And the landlord at the time was Chris Darnell.
Who went on to be landlord of quite a number of
pubs. He was a proper landlord. He was a proper operator. And Lily Savage in the early days would perform there. And Lily was a very good... Paul O'Grady was a very good friend of Chris Darnell. And they were happy days, you know. I used to look forward to going out, to go down at 9 o'clock each night to have a drink. And maybe you might meet a nice little beau. But that was the only way that we could socialise, because there was no iPhones, there was no social media. We relied on the bars.
Absolutely.
To meet people.
Yeah, I mean, I can remember, I think my biggest expenditure from being 22 to being around 50. Was on beer, because you went out to meet people.
You went out to meet people.
You went out to meet your friends as well. And it was a very social scene. And there were gangs as such who would congregate at the same places at the same time. What about Saturday drinking? Because there was a big Saturday drinking scene back in the day, wasn't there?
Yes, in Brighton, I never really linked into that because I was always working. I was always... I was playing, so I would usually be away playing, but the big thing was the Saturday night out in Brighton, and I always tried to get back so I could go out to a club late at night. Over the years, we've had three or four really good places that became social places. Secrets in the old days.
Well, Secrets was one of my favourite places to go to, and I went there once with Louise Renison, the children's author, Some boy came up and sat next to her at the bar, and he said, you're fantastic. He said, most of the people that, you know, are cross-dressing just look like men in frocks. She was, of course, a woman. But it was the sort of place where you had this real mix of older guys and younger guys, but it never felt oppressive in there, even though it was tiny.
No, it was, it was like a family there, you know. It was David and Peter that had it. They were old school and everybody knew them, and we used to love going down there. Revenge, I used to enjoy going to Revenge, but that was a much more different experience. And you know which was possibly became my most favourite place to go to was the old Zanzibar.
Zanzibar back in the day was great. Absolutely. It was terrific. I can remember going to Villagers.
Oh, I forgot about Villagers. That was a naughty place. What were you doing in there?
Well, I never realised it was a naughty place. I just thought it was a bit grubby and a bit scruffy. But it was. Apparently, it was.
It was very naughty.
Yeah. But, I mean, I was so innocent in those days. I think, you know, I was unaware of things like that.
I'd forgotten about Villagers, yeah.
Well, of course, now that's a rather smart cocktail bar up at the top of St James's Street. Yeah. But there were lots of pubs that were gay-friendly. Yeah. Not necessarily gay pubs.
Spotted Dick or Spotted Dog.
The Spotted Dog, yes. Spotted Dog. Well, the Spotted Dog was a masqueraded as a straight pub, I think.
And the Heart and...
Heart in Hand.
And on the corner.
Yeah.
And then there was one over in Hove, a big one, the Rockingham.
Yes.
Which is now...
Lion and the Lobster.
Lion and Lobster.
Yeah.
And I used to like going over there, especially at the weekends. It was very busy.
It was good on a Sunday lunchtime. Yeah. We're going to go to a break, but we'll come back in just a few moments. We'll find out more of James's sordid past in Brighton's pubs and bars. Hello and welcome back to AK Soufflé. I've got James Ledward in the studio with me again today, and we're talking about Brighton's gay scene, and maybe the entertainment side of it, really. It's interesting to see how it's changed over the years and how bars have moved on. Speaking to some other guys for the project, for Live and Let Live, they've been telling me about places in the 50s and the 60s that really, I was amazed how many bars were seen as either gay bars or gay friendly back then.
Yeah.
And of course, I didn't realise that Brighton had one or two lesbian clubs back then, and particularly the Queen of Hearts.
Yeah, and Caves over
and,
in Hove.
And Caves. Well, Caves, I went to Caves once with some girlfriends, and it was a death trap because the steps going down were artexed.
Yeah.
You usually went there when you'd had a few pints, and you'd just come out with grazed elbows that made you look like you got carpet burns. But it was a funny place, that, wasn't it? And it was very much, when it moved from the smaller clubs that we've already talked about to Revenge, which was massive.
Yeah.
I mean, to go from the Beacon, which was tiny.
Yeah.
I mean, we thought it was wonderful and great and big, but Secrets was tiny. Yeah. All these places were absolutely miniature. And then all of a sudden we had Revenge. And around the same time, Paul Kemp had introduced Club Shame.
Yeah.
Which eventually became Wild Fruit.
Wild Fruit, yeah.
And Club Shame moved from the Zap Club on the seafront. Mm-hmm. That was Wednesday nights. It was an odd night for a major gay night out.
Well, but remember, at that time, it wasn't as it was much later, where all the straight clubs wanted a big gay night in there because it guaranteed, you know, big bar take.
Yeah.
At that time, it was very difficult to get a bar to agree to take a gay club night.
So Paul, of course, was taking an opportunity that he wouldn't get on a Friday or Saturday night.
Absolutely, yeah.
And then, of course, it became Wild Fruit and it moved to what had once upon a time been Sherry's at the bottom of West Street.
Coasters.
Coasters, good Lord. Yeah. And then it became massive and suddenly we saw these gigantic gay nights in clubs.
Yeah, I was there on the night when it suddenly all clicked into place. It was interesting. Because when it first opened at what was the Paradox or the Pink Coconut, it was running and it was okay. Then one night, Mama Yvette, who was the hostess, she said, "Oh my goodness me, this is working now." And it was, something happened.
It turned a corner,
and then you know the crowd went up from maybe 500 or 600 people once a month to 1,800, 1,900 with queues outside to get in. And the Wild Fruit, as we know it, was born.
And I think that was an important change because it was a change in the music that was being played. Yeah. But there was also a change in the fact that nights became themed nights.
Yeah.
I mean, up until that point, you'd go to the Beacon Royal, they just played music, but it wasn't themed.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, every night had a different label. It was, you know, it was pop, it was classic disco, it was drum and bass, it was heavy metal, which is about the time I started not going to clubs, I think, because I quite liked a good bop, but I liked a tune.
Yeah, but I can remember at the time people were always complaining, oh, it's £12 to get into Wild Fruit, but the budget to produce the Wild Fruit show once a month was huge.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it Paul Kemp spent money on production.
He's massively invested over the years on the projects that he's done in the city, and of course now he's best known for being the director of Pride with Dulcie. But he must have learnt a lot from doing those nights.
Yeah, they're all, everything he does is concept. Everything is a picture in his head.
Yeah.
And I can remember describing him as king of the clubs, which upset a lot of people. But he was, you know, he his club nights were the best club nights in town when Wild Fruit was happening on Monday nights.
Yes.
And then they changed from Monday nights more to Sunday nights, didn't
Went
they?
Went to Sundays, yeah.
But for me, I just looked forward to the monthly Wild Fruit at that time. It was great.
There was also a change then, because at sort of around that time, everyone was starting to campaign and fundraising became a massive thing. And clubs like Wild Fruit would hold specials and raise huge amounts of money for AIDS-related charities.
Yes, I mean, between Wild Fruit and Revenge, they raised a fortune, you know.
Well, Tony Chapman, who is the owner of, and runs now runs Legends, over the years, the sums of money he has raised for charities out of our social lives.
Yeah, and, you know, the this is something that present businesses need to...
Take a look at.
Because at the time, businesses like Wild Fruit and Revenge saw it as part of their responsibility to invest back into our organisations, our infrastructure.
Yeah.
And that is not the same nowadays. Some people take that aspect of it very seriously. Other people are just ignoring it. And I know myself, I tend not to go to places that don't support the community with fundraising.
Well, there are a lot of club nights these days that are not gay clubs, but gay men and women really enjoy them and they go along to that, so perhaps they don't feel as involved in that community.
I don't know, but I think there's generally been a sort of a disconnect happening, and people just think everything's okay, they don't have to raise money anymore because everything's okay. And they couldn't be so wrong. Now, more than ever, it's important that we raise money to ensure our groups survive, because that money is not going to come from, you know, from the council anymore, because they're not getting money from the government. And so it's really important that we look after ourselves.
I've known over the years, because I write a lot about food and drink, as you can see, and I get most people over the years have been saying to me, can you recommend a gay restaurant? Can you recommend a gay solicitor? And I always reply in the same way. Well, no, I can't, but I can recommend a good restaurant. I can recommend a good solicitor. I mean, that's something that has changed, because there was a point over the last 30, 40 years where you did see the rise of restaurants that branded themselves as being gay restaurants, and certainly law firms that were calling themselves gay law firms. Mm-hmm. Seems to have gone again.
The yes and no. When I look back over the years with the restaurants, I mean, Fudge's on the seafront was my favourite restaurant
loved Fudge's
in town.
Yeah.
Jester's up in St James's Street was a fantastic restaurant. And for a while, they had a run at being gay restaurants. But I'd say that the mood of the community changed as early as about 2002, they became less fashionable and people just went to good restaurants.
Yes.
And it was as people became more confident, you know, about themselves. When I first came to Brighton, people still, well, you know, were hiding away. You had to knock on the clubs to get in and everything was very secretive. As the scene opened up, people definitely became more confident, and the big changer was when Bass invested in what we know as Charles Street now. Mm-hmm. And there we had, within 6 months, three big bars on the seafront, very visible. You had the Amsterdam.
Dominating the seafront.
You had
the center
town. Charles Street, and you had what was called Cruise then, which is now Bar Revenge.
Yes.
And it changed the whole it changed the scene overnight.
And, of course, Legends.
And Legends.
Which expanded
marvellously.
Mm. I mean, they transformed that space, which was very odd and cramped to start.
Absolutely,
But it works really well now. It's really good. If there was anything that you would bring back from those early days, what would it be?
Fudges.
Fudges.
Yeah. They were great.
Sunday lunch with Drake.
Sunday lunch with your friends. That's how I always saw it. And the people that ran it knew what they were doing. And they were networked into the community. And nowadays,
that would be Malcolm,
all the people, Malcolm and Dick.
Dick.
And their English sheepdogs.
Oh, yes. Lovely guys.
Yes. And so, you know, that's what I still think that we're missing, a place like that that brings us all together.
And is there anything now that you would want to see gone?
Oh, I've got to be careful with that.
Yeah, I know.
I don't like... The Golden Handbags voting finishes on Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
And every year at the Golden Handbags, there's places where people can give their comments. And the comments are the same every year. People don't go to venues for three reasons. One, loud music. Two, dirty toilets. And three, rude bar staff. And so I just don't want to have any venues in town that have got dirty toilets or play loud music.
That's great. Thank you so much for talking to us about that. If you've got a story that you'd like to share with us for Live and Let Live, or just on the latest Soufflé, then do get in touch. Come and join us here at the studio in Manchester Street. Drop me a line. You can find my email address on the website for the latest. And thank you again.
My pleasure.
Thank you for watching. We'll see you all very soon. Good night.